ಪಾಠ ಸುಖ ಸಾಧನ ಆಯುರ್ವೇದೋಪದೇಶು ವಿಧೇ ಪರಮಾದರ ಆಯುಕ್ಕಾಮಯ ಮಾನೇನ ಧರ್ಮಾರ್ಥ ಸುಖ ಸಾಧನ ಆಯುರ್ವೇದೋಪದೇಶು ವಿಧೇ ಪರಮಾದರ.
Dear viewers, Ayurveda, the knowledge of life and longevity, is perhaps the oldest existing body of knowledge on the healing process. It is not merely a medical system, it is a way of life. This knowledge system deals with not only the problems of the body and mind, but also that of the human spirit and consciousness. In these days of changing paradigms, when Western science is looking to Eastern logic and spirituality to find solutions to physical, mental, spiritual, and social problems, it is important for us to rediscover this holistic thought process in the interest of humanity at large. It is our humble attempt through this series to bring Ayurveda and its allied knowledge systems into your homes and hearts. We hope we have your blessings in this purposeful journey of ours.
Not a mistake of an individual or a group, it is the mistake of the system. So if you want to save Ayurveda, actually, from my heart, I should say we should close down all these colleges in the country, at least for a period of 10 years. Nothing will happen. All the practitioners will properly practice. Let us take this faculty, reorient them, tell them what is to be educated. Let us look into the syllabus which we have been created and which has been used, what is wrong in it, let us correct it, let us look into it, let us put into public debate, let all the Ayurveda community partake in that, and let all of them give their contribution. Then we will get a sound system based on our understanding. See, the syllabus of today is a product of people with lack of confidence in our own system.
Greatest difficulty which I am feeling to get competent staff, and large majority of these graduates and postgraduates available in India, their knowledge of Ayurveda is very poor.
I do sense a sort of growing diffidence in the Ayurvedic tradition. There seem to be so many Ayurvedic physicians who are so keen to use allopathic medicines, who want to get into emergency surgery and all those sorts of, you know, Ayurvedic tradition, who are not confident that patya or you know, vatam, pitam, kapham, constitutional, you know, ways of looking at things are important. Now, it's a very strange thing. Some of us are beginning to see that as value. These seem to be losing, you know, interest in it.
I feel there's a big crisis, identity crisis, a crisis of perception within the Ayurvedic community, which is reflected very profoundly in the younger generation that come out of the Ayurvedic colleges. It's that they don't really know where they fit in, I mean, in this healthcare scenario. I mean, they don't even have the idea of what Ayurveda can do or where they, I mean, there's a big identity crisis. And the result is that you can find most of the Ayurvedic colleges bring out Ayurvedic doctors who are practicing modern medicine. And that state is in Karnataka also recently, a lot of awareness campaigns have been coming out. So it's just absolutely illogical to think you're studying one science and then practicing something else. So that itself speaks about the deteriorating quality of Ayurvedic education today.
Present education is very substandard in Ayurveda. The syllabus of today that is prescribed by the Central Council of Indian Medicine, that's being followed by several years, And this system has got a lot of disadvantage. The modern techniques and modern principles are very much emphasized and taught in this. That much importance has not been given to Ayurveda. So, in the first year itself, the students are getting confused of which is right and which is wrong, and cannot make a proper correlation of both.
In the first hour, you may think that Ayurveda has become history when you study anatomy. Then in the afternoon when you study Kaya Chikitsa, somebody explains something beautiful of Panchakarma, you may think, oh no, Ayurveda is a specialty, at least in this area we have some. And then somebody, another class and another aspect of Ayurveda is explained, you think that no, it is a medical system only. Then suddenly another, different subjects within a curriculum of a student is just bombarding his mind. He's not equipped to go through this crisis of perception. And ultimately he just forgets all this, and the easier way is to come out. And so for this, what I feel is we have to initiate a dialogue within the Ayurvedic community. We must dissolve this crisis of perception. We must understand what exactly Ayurveda is, or what role. Is it history? If so, let us get it done with it. I mean, we create a dialectical interaction which leads to the unanimous conclusion that it is history. But I'm very sure that it is not history. Or we say that it's only pharmacopoeia. Then that would mean that we don't need an Ayurvedic course. I feel that if almost all of the Ayurvedic colleges are closed down today, it would be all the better for the country. And that much of manpower and resources could be channelized in much better ways. If they study computers or some other thing, I mean, they would be able to do more meaningful contributions. It is a crime to start an Ayurvedic college today.
After independence, mostly Ayurvedic education is institutionalized. We have colleges, universities controlling that, and the Central Council in Delhi, which controls or decides about the syllabi, various syllabi. The educational structure is threefold. We have a graduate called Bachelor's Shuddha Ayurvedic Medicine, or BAMS, what it is. The second is MD, the postgraduate, about 3 years after that. And the doctoral studies, PhD, you are in a position to do it. There are certain centers where it's possible. So institutional education vis-a-vis the Gurukul system, I would say Gurukul system was better. But with increasing number of students, if there are 100 people sitting before a teacher, in a Gurukula it's not possible to communicate individually. So with increasing number of students, institutions are going to be indispensable. You have to live with it. But the problem that we face is competence of teachers.
We have got more than 140 colleges, and we have got a Central Council of Indian Medicine, which is supposed to be, which is governing and which is regulating all the Ayurvedic education, and not only Ayurvedic education, all the indigenous education, including Ayurveda, Siddha and Unani. And unfortunately, this system have blindly copied the curriculum of MBBS. And we even have a semester system today, because MBBS got into semester system. Now, I am not saying that MBBS curriculum is something bad or weak or anything. That is good for MBBS or modern system and office science. Semester is good for them. Why can't we have a system of our own education, which is very well explained in our system?
You see, the Ayurvedic colleges and the other colleges, the kind of backup and the support they need in terms of research, in terms of having land to be growing their own plants, to the equipment, whatever. That the budget allocation for research for Ayurveda, the budget allocation for the whole Indian system, I mean, has been really peanuts. So we have killed it, we've asphyxiated it, not given oxygen. And then over the period, the very aggressive coming in of the pharmaceutical sector, which like Dr. Halfdan Mahler had called neocolonialism for this pharmaceuticalization, increasing pharmaceuticalization and commercialization of healthcare. So the preventive component was totally knocked out, and it became more and more curative, and that to an allopathic level. So this phenomena on one side, asphyxiation of Ayurveda Indian system on one side, has created tremendous distortion.
After the Alma-Ata declaration of 1978 World Health Organization, we have got a definite decision to follow the primary health care path for national health care. And we have got this horizontal activity through primary health care, and we have got this vertical activities called malaria eradication, tuberculosis eradication, such program. These are the main arms of government health care, which penetrates the public. But you will find unfortunately and very paradoxically, that none of these slots give space actually for Ayurveda to operate. So you find an Ayurvedic physician sitting in a primary health center in midst of so many allopathic doctors and allopathic community with allopathic equipments and medicine. He's not even having enough medicine to disperse. Even there is not even a concept of having a simple medicine plant garden in front of a primary health center, which is not imagined by these people. When Ayurvedic physician is sitting, he is supposed to act like an Ayurvedic allopathic doctor. And consequently, this Ayurvedic doctor in course of time becomes a kind of, I should say, disgraded allopathic doctor. Or he imagines that he is also a part of this system. It is nothing, it is not the fault of him, but the system is converting him into a place where he is not operable, where he cannot function.
First, we must stop seeing these systems as necessarily so distinct that they have to be in conflict with each other. There is a common bond that goes through all the systems, the doctor-patient relationship, the need for, you know, need for diagnostic aids or methodology and so on. And I think the real block at present is the desire to be seen as independent of each other, the desire to be growing independent of each other. So you have the ICMR and you have the councils of various research and they don't dialogue. So in a strange sort of way, but this compartmentalization is itself, you know, causing the problem and leading to these sort of questions. My feeling is that somewhere in the future, there will be only one medicine, which is preventively and socially oriented, and it will draw from all these systems. Already, unfortunately, the West is ahead of us in this. You know, if you go to US now, you find the American College of Physicians, which is a highly elitist and highly sort of, you can say, you know, traditional orthodox body, has now been promoting other systems of medicine, studies into it and studying, you know, various other traditions. They have councils looking at it, whereas still today the Indian Council of Medical Research doesn't do anything. It leaves it as a responsibility of the Central Council of Ayurveda or so on, and they don't get funded properly.
I think the perception that not enough is being done is because if a person asks, where can I access this treatment, which is the best place for Panchakarma, where can I get Chara Sutra done, where can I buy quality classical medicines, which are the best doctors and the Veds, who are the people who will be the best people for A problem, B problem, they don't get quick answers. They don't get ready answers for these questions, because I think in creating a demand, we have not looked at the supply side adequately. And it is our effort to see that these questions are answered. And the states should feel on top of the situation and enthusiastic about answering these questions. Because unless that is answered, there will always be this feeling that not enough is being done.
We want to incorporate Ayurveda in our, say, healthcare system. That we are going to do. Today we have this approval for purchasing Ayurvedic medicine, for providing this two kits for pregnant ladies and the children, etc. So we are going to incorporate Ayurvedic system of medicine in this allopathic system of medicine in the healthcare system of India.
Government has announced that they will be setting up a medicinal plant board. So with the coming in of a medicinal plant board, there would be single-minded attention given to the conservation of plants which need to be conserved, cultivation of plants, proper propagation of those plants, proper extraction, harvesting techniques, good agricultural practices, then the proper marketing and export of these plants, whether as raw drugs or as finished products.
This is a big plan of 1,000 crore. And so that quality of these plants is good, the quality is assured. Then we have passed one act recently for good manufacturing practice. So the manufacturing also will be standardized. So that is another part of the policy. And then regarding the promotion of Ayurveda, another system of Indian system medicine, we are going to make after some time, a separate board also, or council, for promotion of Ayurveda. Because, say, APIDA was one organization which was doing that, but they are so much busy with the different, say, agricultural products, And therefore, we think that there should be a separate promotion council for Ayurveda. Ayurveda texts are written in Sanskrit, the ancient language in which India spoke. The language is apt, precise, and to the point. No wonder then that the great acharyas of Ayurveda, who compose verses in this language, chose the sutra form while recording the knowledge of scientific inquiries. The first chapter of each Ayurvedic text has what is called the Sutra Sthana, where the entire content under discussion is condensed and its essence outlined in a few important shlokas.
Sutra shabd jo hai, wo kaise banta hai, wo ek vyakaran ka vishay hai. Jaise ke sutranat sutra hai. जैसे आपके सामने बहुत सारे फूल पड़े हैं पारिजातक के, तो वो बहुत सारे फूलों का समुदाय है, वो सूत्र नहीं है. और जब उसमें से एक सुई से एक धागे में उनको पिरोया जाएगा तो उसको सूत्र कहेंगे. तो उसमें संतति सातत्य ये होना चाहिए.
यू कैन जस्ट विजुअलाइज आयुर्वेदिक नॉलेज एज अ बिग रिवर, बिकॉज आयुर्वेदा सेज दिस. Life is like a flow, river, ceaselessly flowing. And there's just one flow of life, and all the living organs are just streams coming out of this big flow, river of life. So also the knowledge of Ayurveda also is like a big river. And the traditions and manifestations are just like streams coming out of this big river. The source is deep. So my own observations going around, meeting different people in the field of Ayurveda and all that has given me the idea that all that we are seeing today are the streams. Somewhere the river seems to have been lost. People, we mistake now that the stream is the river. So there's so much of conflict and differences of opinion within Ayurvedic traditions that it's very difficult to one Westerner, with whom I interacted once, remarked that it is foolish to say that there is so much of uniformity within the Ayurvedic tradition. They're actually contradictory. They represent different streams of thought. There is no unifying factor. So this state of affairs has led to a crisis of perception within the field of Ayurveda. That is, there are different views of what Ayurveda is, from both the outsider's view and from the insider's view. Within the tradition, we have various views ranging from Shuddha to an integrated approach, whereas from outside, there are people looking at Ayurveda from a historical viewpoint. They say it's all history, there's nothing. Or anthropological, it should have become history, but because of India's cultural milieu where tradition dies hard, we have a living museum, a living history it is. And it will very soon be reduced to. And then we have a sociological view and also an ethnopharmacological view, saying that all that is there in Ayurveda is drugs. And very soon, let us take clues from it and develop new drugs. Like that, so now five possibilities are there for Ayurveda. That is, one is that Ayurveda may turn out to, what is the outcome of all these interactions? That is, that Ayurveda may come back as an independent medical system. Or it may come out as a medical specialty, which means restricted to certain areas like panchakarma or arthritis, or it's not an all-embracing medical system. Another possibility is that it might become a primary healthcare system alone. I mean, all these perceptions point out to five possible outcomes in the field of Ayurveda, that either as a medical system or as a specialty, or as a primary healthcare system, or as a pharmacopoeia. All that is there in Ayurveda, it's going to be a resource to develop new drugs. There's nothing beyond that. Just an information box from which you can pick up useful information, convert it and use it in modern medicine.
ब्रह्मास्त्रपायुषो वेदं प्रजापतिमजीकृहत् ब्रह्मास्त्रपायुषो वेदं प्रजापतिमजीकृहत् सोऽश्विनौ तौ सहस्राक्षं सोऽत्रिपुत्रादिकान् मुनि ते अग्निवेशादिकां स्ते तु चन्द्राणि ते निरे अग्निवेशादिकांस्ते तु पृथक् चन्द्राणि ते निरे
प्रजापतिमजीग्रहः।